Joining us tonight is Colonel Ramon Zagala. He's the spokesman of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Good evening, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good evening, Christian, and all those watching the show tonight. Good evening.
Okay, let's talk about this upcoming acquisition, this purchase by Manila of this Brahmos supersonic anti-ship missiles. How important is this? And what message is the Philippines, the Armed Forces, is sending?
Our modernization program is composed of three horizons. The first horizon is handling internal security operations. And the second horizon is the territorial defense operation. So we are now on the second horizon. And this is the second list of our project list, which is composed of game changers that will give the Armed Forces of the Philippines game changer capabilities that will help us have a credible defense posture. These game changers will help us in anti-access and area denial. So one of them is our missile systems. So recently, the Secretary of National Defense has announced the notice of award for the Brahmos anti-ship missile system. So these are just one of the several missile systems that we will be needing to have a credible defense. So this is for the Philippine Navy. It's land-based over-the-horizon missile systems. And this is a strategic deterrent that we need so that our enemies will think twice. If you have a missile system that is over-the-horizon and is part of a layered defense, we will deny enemy intrusion and future attacks by just having these. So they're part of our game changers.
Okay.
And overall...
When you say deterrent, yeah. Deterrent to what? Because the first thing that comes to mind of a lot of people is the ongoing incursions by China in the West Philippine Sea.
Deterrent so that those aggressive countries, whoever they are, cannot just enter our territory or pose to attack us. So this deterrent weapons, part of our minimum credible defense, are important. No? So that we want to make sure that we have these game changer weapons so that they won't even think, they'll have a second thought. No? And the missile system is just one way of doing this. Of course, in order for you to launch missiles at would-be targets, you need command and control, computer communications, and intelligence surveillance. So we will need this. It's called a C4I star that will help us gather data and mesh all these assets that can be translated into actionable information. So detect muna natin. Let's detect, identify. So that's one of the important factors in our minimum credible defense. So a C4I star that will identify, first is to detect, then identify, so that we can make timely informed decisions to support the AFP mission. So okay. If you, let's say you have already detected a hostile enemy target that poses a threat to our sovereignty, then now you can have the other systems that can come to play in our layered defense. Like the missile systems, of course, we have in the pipeline multi-role fighters and submarines. So these are a mesh of capabilities.
Okay.
That could provide the necessary deterrence.
Okay, let's talk about specifically this Brahmos missile system. What is this exactly capable of?
The Brahmos missile system, this is part of the Philippine Navy's anti-ship, land-based anti-ship missile system. They're capable of engaging large enemy vessels far out our territory so that they cannot, before they reach our shores, we could already engage them. As far as 300 kilometers, we can already engage them before they could even land. So the capability of these missiles really is far-reaching, over the horizon. So basically, it is part of our second layer defense to prevent enemy intrusion. So it's fast, It's high impact. It's reliable missile system that will deter our enemies.
Okay. Now, will this be enough to provide that important layer of protection within our exclusive economic zone, the EEZ, where a lot of incursions have been happening?
It's part of the layered defense. Of course, we need the C4 ISTAR to detect. And then we have a series of other weapon systems that we can use. Other missiles, other missile platforms, such as air defense artillery. We can also have multi-role fighters. We can also have submarines. All are designed to project our armed forces that they could reach enemy anywhere within, let's say, the West Philippine Sea. We will have operational advantages at sea, and aggressors will have to take into consideration the probability of facing not just the missile, the submarine, and our aircraft anywhere without any warning. So it will affect their tactical situation and behavior.
Okay, because I remember when China completed those artificial islands that were a big part of which were built within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. There was a lot of concern when China started deploying a weapon system, right, including communication system, which was already within our backyard. So in this case, this could be a credible deterrent. At least this could make China, for instance, think twice about using whatever they installed there against us.
This will be a clear message to all those who are aggressive to our country, not necessarily just China. Anyone that will come and will threaten our sovereignty and our territorial integrity, these game changers will be key in having a credible defense and deterrence.
Okay. And by the way, why did the Philippines, in particular the Department of National Defense, make this purchase in particular from India? I understand this is a joint technological endeavor between India and Russia, the Brahmos missile system. Why this particular missile system?
When the Congress passed RA 10349, which is the revised and amending the 7898 Modernization Act, it called for 15 years of modernization program from 2030 to 2027. And in this planning stage of the revised AFP modernization program, we had a division. We divided to three horizons, and off the bat, a missile system was needed. It's an immediate need back then to deter, because we knew that having a missile system is fast in being able to deter another aggressor. So in 2013, when we were looking for a missile system, Brahmos offered. Brahmos offered, and they continued to offer to the Philippine Navy and the Philippine Army. In fact, in 2017, the Philippine Army also got into talks with India, with Brahmos, and President Duterte was able to talk to Prime Minister Modi on this, and further discussions were made for the acquisition. So that's how it started. It started really in 2013, and I believe this is government to government. The acquisition is government to government. And right now, the only country that offered us this fast-paced missile systems is Brahmos.
So the Philippine Army is also set to acquire a similar missile system. Is that correct?
Yes. The Philippine Army is also will be acquiring to complement the Philippine Navy. And this is also part of the territorial defense operations of the Philippine Army. It's a contribution of the Philippine Army to over-the-horizon capability to complement the Philippine Air Force and the Philippine Navy. You must remember that the territorial defense operations is a joint effort of all services.
Okay. Now, how about the concern that this might also be used by the Philippine Army against local insurgents, in particular communist rebels among New People's Army members? Will this also be part of the menu of options for the military later on?
The Brahmos missiles is specifically for territorial defense operations. We are winding down our efforts against the internal security operations. In fact, the first horizon, we focused more on equipment that will finish the insurgency. So right now, we are more or less facing about 3,000 left of the New People's Army and a handful of local terrorist groups. So we are slowly transitioning from internal security operations to territorial defense operations. So right now, we expect and that we will severely diminish the New People's Army before the end of the term of President Duterte. And we can focus on territorial defense. And this is exactly what the missile is for. This is for territorial defense operations.
Okay. For the benefit of our viewers, just to give them a clearer idea as to the natural role of a country's military in the national security approach, for instance. You talked about internal security vis-a-vis territorial defense coming from external threats, right? So traditionally, if this were not our situation here in the Philippines, what should have been the focus from the very beginning by the military?
Well, if we have no insurgency, our military will be focusing mostly on territorial defense to prepare our armed forces and to protect our people. If we remember our history correctly, we were attacked by Japan in World War II. And because of that, we abide by the principle charter of the United Nations to live in peace. And in order to live in peace, you must have common bonds with other countries that want this. And so you prepare for war. You prepare for the defense of your country, because we've already had a sad experience of being attacked, and we don't want that to happen again. So we want to make sure that any potential aggressor can be addressed. And we do not stand alone, Christian. We have like-minded allies that help us, like the United States. So our focus, if there is no internal security operations, really is administrative control equipment and training on the sole purpose to ensure the defense of our country is attained.
And internal security would have been left to the police, right? The Philippine National Police. Okay.
Ideally, yes. Ideally, yes.
Now, over the years, we've been hearing this term, credible defense posture. This was a minimum threshold set by the military and defense analysts for the Philippines to be taken seriously by whichever external aggressors there might be. So how far away are we still from that goal of achieving minimum or credible defense posture? Or have we achieved that with this acquisition of military hardware over the past few years?
It's important that we first establish our ability to detect. So detect and identify. So that's a C4 ISTAR. We're on our way there. We're currently able to detect and identify. Next is really to be able to have the capability to intercept. So right now we have the FA-50 that can intercept, but later on we will need multi-role fighters, which are all in the pipeline, and the missile systems and submarines. Once we have all these four systems in play, we can honestly say that we have minimum credible defense, because they're all meshed together to do one thing, and that's to deter our enemy, and if necessary, be able to attack. So right now, once we receive the missile system, we can say we're about 40% in that minimal credible defense. And when our multi-role fighters arrive and our submarines arrive, then we can say we're already there.
Okay. I saw this comment on Twitter earlier. Of course, in the context of assertiveness or adventurism coming from China, the South China Sea, in particular, that portion of the Philippine EEZ, which is called the West Philippine Sea. Okay, this would arrive once the discussions are completed and the process has been completed. But will the Philippines be willing to use that?
Again, these are defense. These are for minimum credible defense. They are never meant to be offensive weapons. So once we are able to detect a threat, then that's the only time we will use it. So threat identification, detection and identification of a threat are key components to this minimum credible defense. Because or else your missile will be blind, your multi-role fighters will be blind, your submarines will be blind. So command and control to make our commanders have situational awareness and that they're so that they can make timely and informed decisions. It is not easy to be to use such weapons just like that. So you need informed decision makers within the Armed Forces of the Philippines to be able to make the decisions to use them timely.
Okay.
So it's really really the C4I star makes us see beyond. And from there, we can make the right decision.
When are these missiles set to arrive in the Philippines? I understand the order was for 3 batteries, right? So when are they going to arrive?
We have not yet received advice, but we're hoping within the next 6 months.
Talk to us also about the upcoming acquisition of other... before we go that, I'd like to talk about the price tag because this might be seen as too costly by people who are thinking of other priorities that should also be focused on by the Philippine government given the limited resources that we understandably have. So $375 million for a missile system. We are in the middle of a pandemic. We understand that that is also a legitimate concern by a lot of people. How would you respond to that?
Well, we understand that the pandemic is equally important. It's an important response from government that we take care of the health of our people. Equally important to taking care of the health of our people is the defense of our country. We need to be able to be ready because we do not know the time and day that an attack can occur on us. So if we do not have the necessary minimum credible defense that we need, then we cannot be able to defend our country well. So yes, we understand that we're undergoing a medical crisis at the moment, and we are a lot of the projects of the armed forces is also delayed for that. And it's very understandable because we put premium to the health of our citizens. But at the same time, we cannot put aside defense of our country. We cannot have a stable economic and flourishing economic activities without an assurance that there is security in our country.
Okay, talk to us about the other military hardware that is in the pipeline. Recently, there was this report of the Philippine purchase of 32 Black Hawk helicopters, right?
Yes, this is the helicopters are added to our project list for Horizon 2. And it is also needed. We could see that what happened in Typhoon Odette. More than 20 of our aircrafts were used to be able to bring relief. So we see that mobility of not just rescue personnel, but relief goods and materials are also key in a timely humanitarian assistance and disaster response. So currently we have 15 of these Black Hawks, and the 32 will definitely help in the future. And these are multi-role. We can use these helicopters not only for military operations, but also for humanitarian assistance and disaster response.
How about the cargo planes? There was this problem before with the C-130s, no? How many are still operational or wala ba sa ngayon?
Well, right now, we have two that we're using and about 3 of the C-295 that are helping in the relief operation. equally important because we're an archipelago, no? So the aircraft that we're using, the C-130, the C-295, the NC-212, they're the ones, the backbone of bringing in relief goods all over the country that were affected, in, let's say, for example, in Typhoon Odette. So it's very important that we also increase the number of our C-130s. In the pipeline, we will be purchasing another 4 and several of the C-295s besides the Black Hawk helicopters. We're also very grateful to the Philippine Navy. They too did their part in bringing in supplies. More than 20 vessels of the Philippine Navy are going back and forth, delivering supplies, goods, equipment to the affected area. So, like the Philippine Air Force, with their lift capability, we need sea lift capability also that is provided by the Philippine Navy.
Mm-hmm. So, in the coming months, before the end of the term of President Duterte, which particular hardware are expected to arrive in the Philippines? I have a list here, but I want to confirm this with you. You know, for instance, there was a deal signed for the acquisition of new Corvettes, right, from Hyundai Heavy Industries. But these are not expected to arrive anytime soon, I suppose.
Yes, we have in under President Duterte this project under Horizon 2. There are 106 projects, and 9 have already been delivered, and 97 are still ongoing. So these are all ongoing. From just an example, the submarine is part of that. The shore-based anti-ship missiles is part of that, and a host of other projects. Like I said earlier, the Philippine Air Force heavy lift air transport aircraft. There are 5 that it's part of the Horizon 2, and so on. 106 projects. So. Of course, hindi natin pwede pagsabay-sabayin the payment and the ordering and the arrival. So what we can say that will arrive immediately is hopefully before the end of the term of the president is the missile system, the C-4 ISTAR, and of course the light the Philippine Army light tank, the 155 howitzer self-propelled battery that we're waiting for. So these are all to arrive.
Okay. And won't the continuing modernization and reform of the Philippine defense sector be slowed down or affected at least by the pandemic? Because understandably, we would have to repurpose certain resources that we have to be able to recover after this pandemic?
Yes, there are really challenges, especially in procurement because it requires funds. In fact, based on the budget, we only get 25 billion allocated by Congress a year. We need 400 billion to be able to have all these items on the list so that we can have minimum credible defense. A lot of governments would have a minimum of 2% of their country's GDP to modernize their military. As we don't spend 2% of our GDP.
I think it's than 1%, no? 1%?
Yes, less. So we really need all this modern equipment that we'll be able to protect the people and secure our state. So we hope, we appeal that hopefully the challenges that we're facing, Congress will help us, the Executive Department will help us, so that we can have the sufficient funds for the AFP Modernization Program.
Okay. Colonel Ramon Zagala, thank you for joining us tonight on the program, sir.
Thank you, Christian, and for those listening and watching, viewing, good evening to everyone.